النهاردة، والنهاردة يمكن ده آخر توك وآخر ويبينار إن شاء الله، يبقى خفيف ومحاول إن هو أسمبلاي أز ماتش أز أي كان. إحنا النهاردة هنتكلم على كيس بريزنتيشن برضو نيونيتال، من حاجات الإندوكرينولوجي إن إحنا ممكن نقابلها. 28 days old boy admitted in the NICU with poor feeding. Routine sepsis was done and he was treated as neonatal diabetes. Neonatal sepsis, sorry. At the fifth day of admission, he was so irritable. They repeated the investigations again, but with no improvement. On clinical examination, he was drowsy, dehydrated, hypotonia, and hyporeflexia. Investigations revealed normal CBC, CRP was mildly elevated and with normal renal functions. His random blood glucose was 89, normal venous blood gases, and the CSF as a sepsis workup was free. One of the residents checked for his electrolytes and asked for calcium level, which revealed that it is 10.5, and he is considered within normal range, and also they searched for irritability cause. Then he referred to us in our university hospital. So what we can do for this child? First of all, we repeated his investigations and we repeated the calcium, which was 18.5, which is very high according to his age. But actually there was a pitfall here that the resident didn't ask for the other associated electrolytes. كلنا عارفين ان احنا لما بنطلب كالسيوم ما نطلبش كالسيوم بس، لازم نطلب كالسيوم، فوسفورس، الكالين فوسفاتيز، البومين، وكمان باراثورمون ليفل عشان نقدر نعرف هو الكالسيوم الهايبر كالسيميا دي ايه الكوز بتاعتها. وده اكشولي اللي احنا عملناه. الكالسيوم هنا كان 26.9، الفوسفورس 2.1، لكن الباراثورمون was 1401. يبقى احنا لما عملنا الريبيتس او الجولدن سامبل بتاعت الهايبر كالسيميا كان الكالسيوم فيها عادي، الفوسفورس قليل، الكالين فوسفاتيز عالي، والباراثورمون was shooting high. واحنا كلنا عارفين ان احنا المفروض الباراثورمون ده الكومبنساتوري ميكانيزم للهايبوكالسيميا، يعني الكالسيوم ليفل لما يقل في البلد الباراثورمون يعلى، لكن كون ان الكالسيوم اصلا عادي بلس ان الباراثورمون ليفل at the same sample عالي، فده معناه ان في مشكله اصلا في الباراثورمون، يعني الباراثورمون هو اللي بيطلع كتير وبالتالي سبب الهايبركالسيميا. عشان كده هنلاقي ان في فوسفاتوريا والفوسفرس قليل، عشان كده احنا we diagnose our patient as having a neonatal hyperparathyroidism. طبعا عشان نكمل بقيه الانفستيجيشنز بتاعته، احنا عملنا التراساوند الابدومين تو تشيك فور ذا كيدني، لكن الحمد لله ما كانش عنده نيفروكالسينوزس. كمان عملنا سيستمي بي سكان اوف ذا باراثايرويد جلاند وذ ذير واز نو باراثايرويد ادينوما اور كارسينوما. اوف كورس treatment and management of this patient is very critical. First of all, we have to stabilize this patient and put him on ECG monitoring. As we will say later, in the ECG changes with the hypercalcemia. Of course, we have to give IV fluids, diuretic, steroids, all of these to maintain and to lower the calcium level. But this patient was very resistant and we add on calcitonin so that we can lower the calcium level, and at some point we may consider peritoneal dialysis in severe cases of hypercalcemia. And here is the ECG changes. As we all know, in cases of hypercalcemia we have a shortened QT interval, which may cause arrhythmia as well. But our patient was unfortunately very resistant to all the medical treatment. So we decide to make a parathyroidectomy, and we face a very big problem because he is so young. And maybe for my knowledge, this is the youngest age to have parathyroidectomy at this age. He did the parathyroidectomy at the age of 40 days. Of course, by an expert surgeon of the maxillofacial department. He did the parathyroidectomy, and also during the parathyroidectomy, they did a parathormone level intraoperative so that they removed the parathyroid and rechecked the parathormone level during the operation, and they be sure that it is decreased after removal of the parathyroid gland. And alhamdulillah, after he was stable and the calcium level was returning normal. Here is my favorite proverb of endocrinology, which is said that the eyes are useless when the mind is blind. يعني احنا لازم نشك في الحاجة عشان نقدر نشخصها، وده اساس الاندوكرينولوجي كله. يعني احنا لما كناش شاكين ان الولد ده عنده electrolyte disturbance او hypercalcemia، ما كناش عملنا calcium level، ما كناش asked for parathormone level، ما كانش الولد ده هيتشخص hyperparathyroidism. في اخر اليوم حبيت بس ان انا احط كده حاجة، ده واحد من الافلام المصرية اللي نزلت من حوالي سنتين ثلاثة اسمه هبتة، كانوا بيتكلم على الـ 7 stages of love وبتاع ماجد الكدواني، وكان حلو جدا. لكن انا الصراحة جبته مش عشان كده، عشان هبتة واحنا بنتكلم على الكالسيوم، هبتة means 7 والكالسيوم ده 7 letters، ف I love abbreviations so I created the hepta of calcium. Because these are the manifestations of hypercalcemia or the calcium metabolism. C for constipation, A for anorexia and poor feeding, as we have in this child, L for the lower deep tendon reflexes. We have to check for the reflexes, and our boy have hyporeflexia. Another C for the calculi or the renal stones, so we have to check for the kidney and check for the nephrocalcinosis also. I of impaired sensorium, so he is irritable, maybe drowsiness. U for unusual bone pain, especially in older children. And finally, M for the muscle weakness. So don't forget the hepta of calcium, and these are the manifestations of hypercalcemia. Again, there is another abbreviation which is called PACME, which are the manifestations usually in the older children of hypercalcemia, bone pains. A for arrhythmia, C for cardiac arrest, so we have to put him on ECG monitoring, K for kidney stones, so we have to do abdominal ultrasound, M for muscle weakness, and E for excessive urination. And don't forget, cases of hypercalcemia may present just by polyuria with dehydration, so you have to check the calcium level in every child with polyuria. Again, if we talk about causes of hypercalcemia, we have to think of the chimpanzee. What is the chimpanzee? It's also another abbreviation for the causes of hypercalcemia in children. C for calcium supplementation, H for hyperparathyroidism, as we have seen in our patients, I for iatrogenic with excessive supplementation of calcium or immobilization in cases of old children, medication, M for medication, P for parathyroid hyperplasia, A for adenoma of parathyroid gland, N for neoplasm, of course this is rare, and Z for Zellweger-Allison syndrome, E, excess vitamin D, and please don't forget and don't prescribe overdoses of vitamin D, especially in neonate or older or younger children. And E for excess vitamin A, and nowadays we said we have seen many cases of excess multivitamins because of the COVID or any immunostimulants, so we have to take care. And finally, S for sarcoidosis or granulomatous disease. So these are the chimpanzee, which are the causes of hypercalcemia in children. This is a simple table showing the causes of hyperparathyroidism. We have primary, secondary, or tertiary. Please check for the primary hyperparathyroidism whenever you have high calcium, low phosphorus, and parathormone is high, which is inappropriately high as the level to the calcium. But in the cases of secondary hyperparathyroidism, that's for example of cases of vitamin D deficiency, the calcium may be low and also the phosphorus may be low, but the parathormone is high. This is high for as a compensatory mechanism for the hypocalcemia. So take care, the secondary hyperparathyroidism, it occurs in every case of vitamin D deficiency rickets. So please, if you just any case of vitamin D deficiency rickets and any one of the doctors asked for parathyroid hormone and it sounds to be elevated, this is not hyperparathyroidism or adenoma or carcinoma or whatsoever. This is a secondary hyperparathyroidism due to hypocalcemia due to vitamin D deficiency. And finally, tertiary, of course, we didn't see it much a lot in cases as, for example, of the chronic renal failure due to long-standing hyperparathyroidism, secondary hyperparathyroidism. This is maybe a somewhat algorithm, which is I will try to make it simplify. any case of hypercalcemia, as we have said, we have to do calcium phosphorus alkaline phosphatase, also for the albumin to check for the pseudo hypercalcemia and check for parathyroid hormone. If you found it elevated, so it is a primary hyperthyroidism. If it is low, so we have to check what with the 25 hydroxy vitamin D and check is it vitamin D intoxication or it is low and this is a secondary hyperparathyroidism. And this is a differential diagnosis of hypercalcemia in neonates and infants up to 2 years of age. And we have said it may be iatrogenic hyperparathyroidism as a congenital or maybe genetic mutation of the calcium sensing receptors or hypervitaminosis D. And don't forget the Williams syndrome. And our patient have no any dysmorphic features. At the Williams syndrome, their baby have some dysmorphic features, congenital heart disease, and also infantile hypercalcemia. And over 2 years of age, began to think of also iatrogenic, maybe also the genetic autosomal recessive or dominant calcium sensing mutations, hyperparathyroidism, and also don't forget other secondary causes as hyperthyroidism, adrenal insufficiency, or maybe chronic renal failure. So please, if you found the case of hypercalcemia, don't forget to consult a pediatric endocrinologist to help you to reach for the final diagnosis and the accurate management. And my final take-home messages, that the hypercalcemia in neonates may present with non-specific common symptoms, as our patient just presented with irritability. So high index of suspicion is needed to diagnose these cases. And also neonatal primary hyperthyroidism is a rare disease, but it must be considered in differential diagnosis in neonates with severe hypercalcemia, especially when the calcium level reaches very high. And finally, thank you. And I hope that you enjoyed our endocrinology session.